Now, there was one other surprise that I had for you today, but I suppose anybody that has looked at the Daily Express this week, and in particular the front page earlier this week, will know that actually it's not a surprise at all. But it is, for UKIP, extremely good news that we have another member of the House of Lords to come and sit with us, a man who was a giant in Fleet Street, a big success in his life, a distinguished member of the House of Lords. Would you please give a huge welcome to Lord Stevens of Ludgate.
Like that, I'm reluctant to spoil it by saying anything. It has taken a long time for me, after losing the Conservative whip in 2004 and resigning from the party, for signing a letter that urged Conservative voters to lend their votes to UKIP in the European elections to make the right decision. I'd just like to say that I admire the Lords Willoughby de Brooke and Lord Pearson for joining UKIP at that time and working hard in the Lords to preserve our country's independence from the Brussels bureaucracy. And if my maths is correct, which I was never much good, their numbers are now increased by 50%. I've been a Conservative supporter all my voting life, so I found such a decision, perhaps simple, difficult. And was hoping forlornly, as it turns out, that one of our governments would realise the need to change our relationship with the EU. Sadly, this has not happened. Those in power still believe that by saying no occasionally, that they have achieved something. But the Brussels bureaucracy always finds a way around it. Forgive me if some of what I say is familiar to you. Governments cannot be trusted with what they say about the EU. In the 1983 general election, Messrs. Blair and Brown won their seats on a manifesto promise to take us out of the EEC because membership drained our natural resources and destroyed jobs. Still true today. Our own Deputy Prime Minister was in favour of an in-out referendum before his promotion. The government promised a vote on the Lisbon Treaty, but when they came to power, they said circumstances had changed and tore it up. Let us not forget that the 1975 referendum was held after Edward Heath's government had taken us in. Michael, now Lord Howard, in the 2004 European elections, called UKIP leaders cranks, gadflies, and extremists. And now we have this Prime Minister, saying that party members are fruitcakes, loonies, and closet racists. Well, I'm glad to join you. They obviously have not yet worked out that many of us are ex-Conservative voters, and one day, who knows, when we're out of the EU, might have returned to the party. They need to meet with their focus groups again and perhaps talk to Mitt Romney's advisors. However, it shows the weakness of these pro-Europeans that they have to resort to this sort of language to try to make their case. It seems to me that if there are loonies out there, there are those who support the present situation. 75% of our laws, as you know, are made in Brussels. These laws, as again you know, are made in secret by an unelected EU bureaucracy, negotiated in secret by the Committee of Representatives of Nation States, and decided in secret by the Council of Ministers, where we have less than 10% of the votes. They are then confirmed by the Europhile EU Parliament. The House of Commons and the House of Lords are irrelevant. How many EU laws or directives the House of Lords European committees, which do great work, reject it? None. Because they cannot. And our own EU commissioner, as has been mentioned, does not even bother to attend the meetings. We are in an organisation that is so unsure of itself, not surprisingly, as its accounts have been qualified for 17 years. Nearly 5 billion euros has gone walkabout. That it uses threats to control its present and former employees. Under the Treaty of Rome, commissioners can be deprived of their pensions for, let us say, disloyalty to the cause, as can employees under their staff regulations. Our own government was unable to stop an increase in the recent Brussels budget, despite all the bluster. Not surprising, really, since they seem unable to reduce their own spending, which only fell by 1.1% last year. Our government's deficit has been reduced by increasing taxes, something the EU is desperate to do, raise and collect more taxes from the member states. The clincher for me was when in July this year the Prime Minister said in a newspaper interview with the Telegraph that he wants to negotiate a new settlement with the EU with powers returned to Britain, but he will not countenance leaving the EU and says he would never campaign for an outvote in a referendum. I think it would be bad for Britain, he said. When I look at what is in our national interest, we are not some country that looks in on ourselves or retreats from the world. Britain's interest, trading a vast share of our GDP, is to be in those EU markets, not just buying, selling, investing, receiving investment, also helping to write the rules. What a joke. If we were outside, we would not be able to do that. He added, it comes back to this. Who are going to be the winning nations for the 21st century? If your vision of Britain was that we should just withdraw and become a sort of greater Switzerland, I think that would be a complete denial of our national interests. Well, let's just examine that thinking for a moment. The UK does less than 40% of its trade with the EU, a declining percentage, as our trade with the rest of the world has expanded at a faster rate and continues to do so. Trade with the EU accounts for less than 6% of our gross national product, hardly a vast share, and the EU is only 12% of the world's gross national product. However, 100% of our gross national product is affected by EU regulations. The vast majority of the UK's total trade, both inside and outside the EU, is tariff-free. He talks about rewriting the rules, but he cannot. The rules are made by an unelected EU bureaucracy. The House of Commons and House of Lords are irrelevant. Furthermore, all our experience indicates that if the UK objects to anything, the Eurocrats find a way around it. Thank goodness he did not trot out the nebulous figure of 3 million more unemployed if we left. This seems to be the only figure the Europhiles can produce in support of their position. And where on earth does it come from? The EU would not close their markets to our goods. They export more to us than we to them. Can you imagine the shrieks of rage from Mercedes and BMW? And the average level of GATT trade tariffs is 1.5% and falling. We trade perfectly well with the rest of the world without the EU controlling every aspect of our lives. The Lisbon Treaty states that any country leaving the EU can negotiate a free trade agreement. It is a total myth that remaining inside enables us to write the rules. Then he drags Switzerland into the debate, a country that has prospered outside the EU. Switzerland has all the advantages of commercial access without the costs of full membership. It participates in free movement of goods, services, people, and capital. It can sign trade agreements with third countries. Switzerland is a fine example of a country prospering outside the absurd EU regulatory system. Norway and many other smaller nations survive perfectly well outside the EU, as does the rest of the world, which accounts for nearly 90% of the world's output. UKIP, as we all know, is not a one-policy party. It has a manifesto covering clear policies in, for example, crime and immigration. In the circumstances, I'm happy to stand up for the United Kingdom, running its own affairs, even if badly at times, rather than being run by unelected officials in Brussels. At least we can vote ours out. So let the people decide with an unambiguous referendum, in or out. No more fudging about returning some powers from Brussels. We can negotiate from a position of strength for an orderly departure with a clear out majority. I cannot close without thanking and congratulating Express newspapers for their splendid campaign. Just to say that I always thought I was a tycoon, but it wasn't confirmed until I read the Daily Express on Tuesday. Thank you for asking me to talk.